today we're talking about why current US electoral maps look like images that parents of first graders put on the fridge. Aw, look, honey, our daughter drew a spaceship. Oh wait, no, that's just Illinois' 4th congressional district. Now, gerrymandering's an odd problem because we're not even sure if gerrymandering's a problem or a solution. And it's never a good sign when explaining the morality attached to an issue is dramatically more complicated than explaining the issue itself. So, what is gerrymandering? Well, it's when you try to pack all of your political opponents into one district, so that district is a foregone conclusion. Think Democrats in New York. Yeah, I might have more political influence voting an American Idol than I will ensuring that whatever Democratic candidate wins by one additional vote with the millions he'll already win by. While you spread out your people into a lot of states where you win by a small margin. Think of it like a football team. The goal is to get your opponent to blow their entire budget on just one player. But he's really, really good. While you buy an entire mediocre team. I mean, I know Tom Brady's good, but if it were just him against the entire New York Jets team, well, I know where I'm putting my money. Alright, so that sounds like a bad thing, right? Well, the Supreme Court decision handed down today deals with partisan gerrymandering, but we've seen decisions in the past that rule on racial gerrymandering unconstitutional.
The judges ruled Friday that in 2011, Republican state legislators engaged in racial gerrymandering by diluting Hispanic voting strength in two Republican-held districts and by packing Hispanic voters into a neighboring district.
Okay, that still sounds pretty bad, right? Well, let's talk about the ethics of Florida's 5th congressional district, which, wow, that looks about as natural as a New York City hot dog. Essentially, every part of the animal that Chinatown couldn't turn into a belt. Alright, so clearly something's going on there. Well, what if I told you that that district was packed to the brim with African Americans? That would probably still infuriate Democrats because of the conversation we just had. But then, what if I were to tell you that, at least in theory, congressmen do more than just mindlessly vote on party lines, and are actually intended to advocate for certain communities. These congressional districts are minority-majority districts, designed to give minorities representation in Congress. I mean, hypothetically, if we were to do a perfect job not gerrymandering districts, so there were no unfair majorities of party or race, well, then that would mean that every district would reflect the wills of the majority demographic of America. Oops, we just made it so that every district is 53% white, because you can't put minority voters together in their own district. So, this presents the problem that the Supreme Court tried to answer in this case on partisan gerrymandering. So let's jump right in, because
the Supreme Court has decided not to rule in two major gerrymandering cases. The court cited procedural faults by Democrats in Wisconsin and Republicans in Maryland.
Oh wow, very conclusive stuff. But if you're not going to answer the question, then how did you still write 41 pages of content? Well, and I hate to sound like a guy who just read a psychology book and wants to put his two cents into every conversation, but in not answering the question, they kind of answered the question. Now, I'll clarify because I think even Yoda would be scratching his head at what I just said. The Supreme Court didn't just listen to the oral arguments and think to themselves, eh, too long, didn't listen. No, instead they looked into the legal standing of the people's rights to even sue for gerrymandered districts. Because a plaintiff who complains of gerrymandering but who does not live in a gerrymandered district asserts only a generalized grievance against governmental conduct of which he or she does not approve. Alright, so what does any of that mean? Well, to put things in a more relatable terms, and bear with me, but do you remember the woman who got $640,000 when she spilt hot coffee on herself at a McDonald's and sued for personal injuries based on third-degree burns? Well, imagine I went in and sued McDonald's for personal injuries because that woman got third-degree burns and expected to win the case. That would make absolutely zero sense. Now, the same logic applies here because the plaintiffs here allege that they suffered such injury from partisan gerrymandering, which works through the cracking and packing of voters. Alright, so what is cracking and packing, besides a great boy band name? Well, it's the act of either packing everyone into one district or cracking them up into multiple districts where they'll lose in every one. The problem here is that the plaintiffs were alleging personal vote dilution in districts they didn't live in, which is just not a thing you can do. And the same logic applies to racial gerrymandering. Plaintiffs who complain of racial gerrymandering in their state cannot sue to invalidate the whole state's legislative districting map. Such complaints must proceed district by district. If you're mad because you realize that the Dakotas were split to give one party twice as many representatives in the House, you're not gonna all of a sudden be taking a Sharpie to Hawaii. You're gonna fix the specific problem you're alarmed with. Now, I hear some of you saying, but Stephen, what if the entire map is nothing but gerrymandered districts? Do we really have to go district by district in what is essentially doing a jigsaw puzzle by cutting out your own pieces as you go? Well, don't worry, because the Supreme Court provides a concrete answer to that legitimate problem by saying, "We leave for another day consideration of other possible theories of harm not presented here, and whether those theories might present justiciable claims giving rise to statewide remedies." Oh, come the fuck on, Justice Roberts. You can't just, "That's all I have to say about that," your way out of the most important part of your opinion. So, we know they can't sue the state for gerrymandering their entire map the way they did. But we're sure there's a way, we're just not creative enough to figure it out. Don't give up hope though, because Justice Kagan wrote separately about her own ideas. A plaintiff residing in each affected district can show, through an alternative map or other evidence, that packing or cracking indeed occurred there. And if that test is met, the court can proceed to decide all distinctive merits issues and award appropriate remedies. Alright, so we don't have to do this district by district. If you can all at once, district by district, prove that each district is gerrymandered and get someone from each district to testify that they have suffered personal injury from vote dilution. Sounds easy. Although it beats the hell out of their current strategy, which relied solely on a personal injury claim from a man who acknowledged in court that he is not among the injured in a vote dilution challenge. Oh my god, are you kidding me? There are a ton of people who live in gerrymandered districts in Wisconsin, but nope! The guy who filed the personal injury case lives in a district that he himself admits wasn't gerrymandered. What are we even doing here? I mean, no duh they want to hear from someone who's actually suffering the consequences of this. Now, this case isn't actually over as some people imagine it to be. It wasn't dismissed, but rather remanded. Meaning that, instead of being game over, this is halftime. So get in that locker room and regroup. Find some actual victims. Now, this annoyed Justice Thomas, who wrote on the shortest justice opinion I have ever seen, saying, "I do not join part 3, which gives the plaintiffs another chance to prove their standing on remand. When a plaintiff lacks standing, our ordinary practice is to remand the case with instructions to dismiss for lack of jurisdiction." That would normally make sense, but in this case, where the legal team of the plaintiff apparently had to seek legal counsel from the justices overseeing it, man, they can use all the help they can get. Thank you, and that's all I have to say about that. Hey YouTube, if you want to support independent journalism investigating the Supreme Court, subscribe to my YouTube channel for our weekly Supreme Court Saturday episodes. As always, leave me a comment if you have an important case you think I should research, and thank you for watching.